Check. Check. Check, check, check. Check, check. Testing, 1, 2, 3, testing. Testing, testing, testing. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Check on this. Testing, testing.
Inside, I want a little bit quieter.
Check, check, testing, 1, 2, 3, testing, 1, 2, 3, testing, check. Check, check.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Jambe yong lo chong ze loi kang ge lo de dim ye tin de ro ni ta ra ya nam da ya ra so je ne tung ge ji ja zi ki ro ni ge tu ka ro ya le bom ze kang da se pe tsen da ma de mi tom dung ai che se ve Do choi kyun lai pu che tar che yin lai chuk choi yang de song. Do tarai ke doi nyu moi nyu loi le ke kya doi dom zi chin. Ma ri mi se dung ai nyu ge ji nye kyun ze ra de nam. Dene ta che sai kyun dar son yun de zoe gya se te ve ku. Che tai che tai chung nye jen te dak le me tse jam be yang lai du. Tse den ke ge ken rai ve se che dak le te mo men pa ya rap so ne. Ka dang ten che yun lo e to kwa ye. Lo de po pe nang wa tse to e so. So, good morning, everyone. I hope you had a good night's sleep. I hope you are well rested. And so now, today and tomorrow, in this session, we will be talking about, 12 links of dependent origination. So I will do my best to explain them the most, let's say, clear way. And hopefully, this teaching, not just my teaching, but generally all the teaching, and especially this teaching on dependent origination, will help us to have a clear picture of what samsara is all about, how samsara meaning us, how we, ended up in samsara, and how actually we can also escape from this existence if we, if we want. So this is the essence of the teaching, actually. Of course, I will try to explain you, as far as I can, as much as I can, or perhaps as much as I can remember. But also, we don't exactly have a whole lot of time to go through so much in detail. But sometimes I think that maybe it's not about the detail, correct? Sometimes it is. But sometimes it is not really about the detail, but rather about, understanding it, or it's rather about, realizing it actually. If you catch it, if you grasp the meaning, that's pretty much it. Nothing much to say. Like, let's say, Buddha only said, everything's emptiness. Okay, let's say Buddha said, form is emptiness. That was it. He didn't, take 10 days to explain what is the meaning of this form is emptiness. He didn't say anything, no? Also, Buddha only said everything is suffering. He didn't explain anything, and that was more than enough for his disciples to understand what Buddha was trying to convey, you know, what message Buddha was trying to give, and they got it. And that's how they got liberation, in the first recitation of the Four Noble Truths. That's what I'm trying to say. Usually we call, you know, 12 recitations, but actually recited only one time. And this, I think, is also, you know, it also depends on our capacity. Am I slow enough? Okay. In the Prajnaparamita teachings, you know, Buddha often mentions that there are these two group of people, or practitioner in general, one with a very sharp faculty, and one with a dull faculty. So the one with the very sharp faculty are the practitioners with the highest wisdom to comprehend the meaning right away, without need of any further interpretation or explanation or elaboration at all, like Buddha's five disciples. All the disciples of Buddha, not only five of them. You know, during Buddha's time, Buddha never actually explained anything, correct? He did not. He just straight away said things. So there is no such thing as commentary, for example. But when Buddha uttered a word, the audience, they understood it right away. Not only understood, they realized it right away, the whole audience. Of course, it's a different, you know, audience, and different time, and different, let's say, teacher. But at the end of the day, it was the audience, correct? That actually mattered, not the Buddha. Because Buddha himself didn't need to remind him about his own knowledge. So Buddha was pretty much sharing his realization, the path that he chose. And he was so, this is why, you know, the compassion of the Buddha is really, you know, really selfless. There's no generous like that, actually, you know. He, without hiding anything, without thinking that, oh, if other people became Buddha, then there will be many more Buddhas, you know. I will not be the only Buddha. I will have competitions. Things like that. It's our way of thinking. No such thing at all. He wholeheartedly, it was not that first he started, you know, generating bodhicitta, and then he kind of think, okay, now I must act. No, like Karmapa was saying there yesterday, no? You just do it spontaneously. Everything happens spontaneously, naturally. One cannot force it, correct? It's very true. How can you force your emotions? You cannot force your emotions whatsoever. You can think, I can force, that's okay. But can you really force? You can't. You cannot force to feel love for someone if you don't love someone. Otherwise, you can just force to love everyone, and everyone can love everyone. Why not force, you know? Why do all these such things? Just force yourself. If you can forcefully develop these qualities, then what is the need of all these teachings, you know, all that? No, actually. Anyway, so again, I'm kind of, you know, so therefore, audience, it's about audience, the capacity of the audience. And then, to be very honest, the capacity of the audience gradually changed over the time, not directly, not suddenly, not like, you know, overnight. It took quite pretty long time to, you know, to change the, not change, but we had to change the audience, actually. Now we are the audience. Before that, first Dharma was in India, the audience was different. Okay, let's see, during the time of Nagarjuna, Saraha, during the time of Nalanda, right? Nalanda, there were many great institutes in India. I want to share some of the names. Most of you maybe know, but I just want to share in case. Nalanda, I think everybody knows. Besides Nalanda, there is the Vikramashila Institute. Besides that, there is also a very well-known, actually, institute called Somapuri, Udentapuri. Takshila, Takshashila we call it. Takshashila was actually the very first institute, but if my understanding is correct, not everybody who studied in Takshashila was a Buddhist. But Buddhist was taught there. So maybe it's like nowadays in the university where you have this, you know, religious department or whatever you call it, section, kind of like that. So Takshashila. Anyhow, now why I brought it up is, you know, during the time of those scholars from the first century, you know, from the time of Nagarjuna, actually all the way to the end of Nalanda Institute, even after that, the audience really changed. This is why there was Tantra, actually. Okay, I really don't know anything about Tantra, but all I know is that the reason why actually it came, so to speak, from the historical point of view. I was going to say something, but don't misinterpret that. It is said that Tantra is meant for this time, actually. But it does not, we should not think, oh, that means we are, you know, very special. No, actually. It means we are not very special. Therefore, we need a very special method. But we misinterpret it, thinking, oh, they gave us something very special, I'm special. No. Like Buddha's time. Buddha didn't need to teach Tantra at all, because there was no need for people to teach Tantra. So like, emptiness, got it. No? Now, no idea. What is emptiness? Then Buddha says, form is emptiness. Emptiness, form. Form is emptiness. What is emptiness, form? Oh, so confusing. See? Then Buddha says, okay, never mind. Do the Tantra stuff. No, I'm not actually kidding. It's a fact. You know, if you learn the Tantra, they will say why these things are happening. But at the same time, I'm not saying that in our time there are no audience who don't have that kind of capacity. There are, actually. There are, I very much believe, audience, but in number, maybe not that many. In number, much fewer, I guess. But 100% there are, actually, you know, audience, practitioners, I must say, you know, who have that capacity like Saraha, capacity like, you know, Nagarjuna. There are, of course, they exist. It's not that, you know, that our time is completely devoid of all these great masters. It's not. We have proof. We have, you know, all these great masters that now exist in India, in Tibet. They are the proof, you know, so. But how many are there? Not like Buddha's time. During Buddha's time, everybody in the audience was an arhat, was a bodhisattva. So there were like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people, thousands and thousands, you know, who were all actually noble beings. I shouldn't say everyone was Buddha, but they all have reached very high stages of the Aryas, arhats, you know, Aryas, realization of emptiness. But now the number is much, much fewer, no? Lesser, but there are. Anyway, so they're coming back to that. And due to this reason, then the audience, the practitioner's mind, you know, is changing. And so then the dull faculty. Earlier, the practitioners almost 100% were with higher capacity, with the sharp faculty, I'm thinking. Okay? And now, maybe 98% is with dull faculty. But it doesn't mean negative, though. It means it's like a knife. You have a knife, and it's not very sharp. So no big deal. You can sharpen it, no? You can always sharpen it. What's the big deal? Because you didn't use it for so very long time. So therefore, now it got stained. All you need to do is wash the stain, sharp it. It'll be very sharp. It's our mind. Our mind is a little bit stained. Why? Okay, from my example, and because I didn't practice. Not because I didn't practice in this lifetime, but I didn't practice in any of the lifetimes whatsoever. Naturally, my mind will be like this knife that you never use. You keep it, keep it, keep it, keep it, and then it will become very dull, you know, stained. Yet, the sharp, you know. Same way, our mind is like that. We call it Buddha nature mind, whatsoever. That is actually the quality of it. Sharpness of the mind. The brightness of the sun. How can you take away the brightness of the sun? You can't. It doesn't matter how old it is at all. So it doesn't matter how old my mind is, actually. Or how old the stains are, right? Actually, now I think I'm changing my subject to Julama instead of dependent origination. Anyways, it's like this. So I'm just trying to tell us it's the truth, really. Because then you think, I don't want us to be discouraged saying, oh, Khenpo says is a time when, you know, the audience have only dull faculty. I'm speaking the fact. But there is a way to make this dull, you know, mind very sharp, actually. But I think we are doing that. Learning, reflecting, meditating is the way to, you know, sharpen our innate wisdom. You know, wisdom innately exists, actually. Is spontaneously exists, so to speak, you know. So, therefore, anyways, so it came because of this teaching that I was speaking about. Actually, I said there were times when there were no much detailed explanations. And there are times now when there are lots of detailed explanations, so to speak. So so it depends how you understand. Okay. So never mind. In the sense that when you listen to Dharma, never mind what you understood or what you didn't understand, okay? Because there will be a time when you will understand everything, actually. So we should not be so very worried about that. That's my point. Right now, I mean, I come to the Dharma practice. We are all here gathered together, you know, to have a nice time. You know, and this ninth time with Dharma, actually, correct? And it's all about really being here and being present. That's what matters. Being present, not physically, of course, you understand what I'm saying. Being present with all our motivation, with all our inspiration, with all our devotion, that is when you are being present here. That is what counts. This is why I was yesterday was speaking about when we listen to the Dharma, we need to be, you know, attentive. We need to, you know, give undivided attention to it. So the presence of these are very important, really. Physically, you can be present anywhere. That's not the important part here. But I need to be present here, you know, with my mind, with all the qualities of the mind, and especially, you know, devotion, we can say it, confidence, inspiration. And I'm very, very sure that, you know, you all are here and you all have that in you. So that is very important, because that is like this field, you know, where we are growing our Buddhahood. When the field is very good, when the seeds are very good, the fruit is always very good. The harvest is always very good. And the harvest is the Buddha. So there's no doubt it will produce it. But if the field upon which you sow that is not as good, then the harvest won't be that good. Correct? The Buddha, so that, those things. So I need to come back to the troubling now. Troubling, dependent origin. First, I just want to very briefly explain the meaning of dependent arising. In Tibetan, the word is, first, before I forget, in Sanskrit, the word actually is pratitya samudapat. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly, because I never studied Sanskrit. It's just hear and say a thing, you know. But that's perhaps the word, that is what the word is. It's called pratitya samudapat. And when you translate that into Tibetan, the Tibetan word is not only tendel. Tendel is the short form of that. The longer form is actually tenching delvan juwa. And then in English is dependent arising. Anyhow, so just, but now the meaning. The meaning, in short, Buddha says that the one who understands the meaning of dependent arising will understand the meaning of, you know, the emptiness, the meaning of true nature of the mind. Because dependent arising nature of the phenomena is emptiness, and emptiness is the dependent arising nature of the phenomena, so to speak. So I have to say it a little bit in short term. And it is actually very true from what I gathered, from what I sort of pictured the meaning of dependent arising meaning. You know, it's a concept, it's a wisdom, I must not concept, it's a wisdom which helps to dismantle the idea of solidarity, you know, the idea of concretely existence, the idea of inherent existence. We have this idea, you know, that everything exists inherently, truly, solidly, that thing, you know, we have that concept. But now, let's say self. For me, self is concrete, solid, inherent. Now Buddha says, self is emptiness. The reason is because self is of nature of dependent arising. Immediately idea that self is independent is destroyed. Are you following what I'm saying? It's destroyed, actually. Right there is the merit. Right there is the fruit. That's what we need to do. We need to destroy our mundane way of thinking, habit of misapprehending everything. So this is just to give you an idea about that, the meaning of dependent arising. So therefore, now let's say mind, you know. So from mind, let's say compassion or perhaps kindness, anger, emotions. I'm saying so many things. We pick one of them, so anger. Now, for me, anger is like a solid feeling, you know, so very solid that you physically kind of feel it, so to speak. Because, you know, all this vibration that you experience, all this, I mean, you know, that's why we call it temper, I guess, you know. So, and we pretty much feel it physically. So therefore we think, oh, it's very solid. This emotion, anger, jealousy, it's very solid. And Buddha says, no, no, that's not right. This, you know, all these emotions are of nature of selfless. They are selfless. They don't exist. Why? Because you want to look into the nature of your that thought, your that mind, you know, your that feeling. They are all nature dependent arising. So they are, you know, these feelings, this mind, they are not independent at all. Therefore they are not true. So this way, anyway, it's a lot, man. Then if I kept saying this, we have to go into the madhyamika system actually, because this is the very foundation of the madhyamika, you know, system, so to speak, or madhyamika school, the dependent arising, you know, the theory of dependent arising. It's not only theory though, it's also wisdom, I must say, but it is a theory, a logic, a reason that, you know, that actually is in accordance with the true nature of the phenomena. So therefore this realization is a very, very profound wisdom. So the wisdom of dependent arising, meaning wisdom that I gain through understanding the true meaning of the definition of dependent arising. Right now I'm not talking about the Tao Ling, but the word. And not the word, but the term, right? This term called dependent arising. It's huge, actually, very huge. So, yes, so this is to help us to really, you know, to really break this, you know, break this concept, break this, you know, this process, ordinary way of thinking, you know. We need to break that, you know, like breaking the concepts. For example, crack, we need to break the concept. It's not that we do it on purpose. Here, I'm not forcefully breaking the concept of existence and sort of destroy that. And then instead of that, I build up emptiness. No, actually, I'm not doing that. Here, I'm just trying to really understand the truth. You know, truth. And when the truth is revealed to me through this kind of wisdom, very automatically, very naturally, it breaks all of your concept. Concept that things are true, concept that, you know, self exists true, all that concept. Breaking the concept is the most profound, you know, way of of working with the mind, actually, right? Especially, I think, in our Mahamudra teachings, we speak a lot about breaking of the concepts. So, we have a very routine, you know, very routine and very boring, actually, you know, way of thinking. Don't you think so? We always think the same thing. Not just this lifetime, whole lifetime, always same. You know, always same. Very routine way of thinking. So we never, you know, had a breakthrough at all. Now here we are, getting a chance to have this breakthrough. That's all we need, actually. So Buddha gave us this method. Now I will have breakthrough. Correct? It's really profound. We really need to do that. If you didn't do that, you are stuck. No matter how many teaching you will receive, years and years and years, if you don't get this breakthrough, You are stuck. So, no, you are always stuck. I'm always stuck. Because I think because fear. Fear, actually. But this fear is a false fear. Everything is a false fear, actually. But it's a false fear. So we need that break, you know, a breakthrough. Anyway, I think I'm saying too much on that. I also need to finish the 12 links. So that is pretty much, okay, so this was a good, you know, kind of term that I remembered. Dependent arising, the wisdom of the dependent arising helps to break through our routine, boring way of perception, actually. Ooh. I guess Manjushri is helping me out here. He's like, oh, Khenpo, I must have to come to you because you are so lost. No, it's like that, you know, it's really like this, like, oh, wow, I'm otherwise, you know, he's actually of compassion to you, not to me. It's like, whatever, I don't care him, but these people who came from so far away, I won't allow this Khenpo to see something, you know, that's not correct. So I feel a little bit heavy here, maybe he's sitting on here. I'm kidding. Okay, so now I need to come back to the 12 link before I say all this lot of other stuff. And now the 12 link, yes, as far as the 12 links of the dependent origination, dependent arising are concerned, traditionally there are two sets of dependent arising. The first set of the dependent arising is what we term as the uninterrupted, you know, the uninterrupted process. Actually, the uninterrupted process. So this uninterrupted process is the process in which Vara is built, in which, you know, yes, actually, has been built, samsara has been constructed and projected. That is called uninterrupted process. The 12 links are always process, you know, of the 12. And then the other set of the 12 links is, actually there is a word for that, in fact, you know, for this. We call it, you know, the, okay, the other set of the 12 link is reversed order of the 12 link, we can say, reversed order. And in this case, then the process should be interrupted, actually. So we can see the 12 link in which the process are gradually interrupted. But the word we generally, traditional way, you know, of translating that is what we call reversed order of the 12 link. Like, for example, meaning just later on we'll speak a little bit on that. What does it mean, interrupt? If ignorance, you know, is interrupted, correct, then there can be no karma, correct? Karma will be not there. The second link won't be there. Then if there is no second, there will be no third, no fifth, none of them will be there. No samsara. It's interrupted in that way. So reversed, meaning it's a cessation, actually. When they are uninterrupted, which sounds good, which actually not good. Now the ignorance is arising in me, and I don't do anything about it. I don't interrupt it, you know. How do I don't interrupt it? I don't, let's say, learn, reflect, meditate, so I don't interrupt the, you know, the process of the ignorance. Then this ignorance, you know, let's say, starts functioning. When it starts functioning, it starts creating. What does it create? Or condition? Or it, you know, create and
compose, create, compose. Not a poem, though. It composed the karma, actually. I think you all know that. So therefore, that's way. Then you can see, you know, because the ignorance was not interrupted, due to that, the ignorance, you know, started functioning. And because of that, it created the second link, formative action. And the formative action was also not interrupted. Then the third link and the fifth link and all of that, rest of them. And this is how then this the cycle of, you know, our birth, rebirth in the world, in the samsara of all sentient being, is uninterrupted. Why? Because these are uninterrupted, these 12 links. So these are cause, these are results. So we never, as a human being, me, perhaps I never did anything to, you know, about it, correct? Maybe I have no idea, actually, you know. I mean, until I met the Dharma, until I learned it, I have no idea where I came from, actually. Yes, you can say rebirth, but I honestly have no idea where I came from, where I began, how I ended up here. Maybe I never asked those questions to myself. So perhaps it didn't bother me at all, so to speak. But what really bothered, then maybe you may be thinking, oh, if it didn't bother you, why bother to know this now? No? Then, okay, these things maybe didn't bother me. What bothered me was my existence, my suffering, all these things. That is what is bothering me. But that, these things that is bothering me, that's bothering my life, correct? Are result of 12 links. There is no other result of anything. Usually we always say it's your karma. But karma comes from ignorance. Without it, karma can never come. You know, suffering is bothering me. If difficulties are bothering me, then, you know, you should know, you know, where they came from. Then the cause should also bother you, you know, right? The cause of those. So this knowledge, what I'm trying to explain, I guess, is that first we have to have this information, a very clear understanding of cause and effect, actually cause and effect. We are cause, we are effect both, okay? It's not that you are only result or effect. We are effect. But we are also causing a lot of, for myself, I'm causing a lot of things for myself. I am caused by myself. No one caused you. Actually, that is the truth. But then we always think somebody else caused me, you know. No, nobody caused you. anyhow, so yes, so this, now, this kind of meditation, you know, analyzing the 12 link is what I think is really very helpful. Understanding the profound meaning of cause and effect, actually. You know, samsara is a cause, samsara is an effect. Let's say I am a cause, I'm an effect. Junde, ule, and ju, and ndu. There are three things, le meaning karma, ju meaning cause, ndu meaning result. So it means karma is both the cause and the result, actually. So we need to think about that. We need to analyze that. Just like a doctor, you know, he analyzes what caused you this, you know, this sickness. And then only after root of the cause, then they would prescribe you medicine. Same way, we need to do that. Anyhow, so this is the meaning of, I think I explained a little bit too much the meaning of the dependent origination, uninterrupted process of the dependent origination, correct? Yeah, that is what it meant, uninterrupted process of the dependent origination. And process is a very good word, actually. From my thinking, from my English point of view, it's a process, actually. So anyway, that's it. So there are this, generally speaking, like generally you know, but in a very traditional way, the uninterrupted process also is called the direct order of the 12 link. Direct order. Order in which, you know, they arise one after the other from ignorance all the way to the sickness and death is called, you know, 12 links in forward sequence. Actually, 12 links in forward sequence, 12 links in direct order. There are many ways of saying that. The other is actually a reversed order. So the reversed order actually brings us liberation. I think we speak a little bit more on that after when I finish the explaining the 12 links. Okay, so now I'll try to explain the 12 links. So I think now that was the definition of dependent arising and these two types of dependent arising of the forward sequence and, you know, reversed sequence or forward, you know, let's say, or direct order or reversed order, that too. Now, you know, the 12 links. First, I will explain the 12 links, what are they, in brief. First of the 12 link, I think most of you are familiar with that, or maybe everybody actually, is ignorance. Okay, now let's discuss few words here, okay, in English actually, and I'd like to, you know your opinion on that, because we all know actually what it means. So there are two words that I came up with. One of them is misapprehension, and one of them is misconstrue. So my way of defining the ignorance is ignorance not only misapprehend the meaning, it also misconstrues the meaning. And I like this from my English point of view. I like it because I think there is two things in it. Okay, first, what does it mean by you misapprehend the object or you misapprehend the meaning? Now let's say Buddha says everything's emptiness. The way how I can misapprehend that is that I can think, oh, that means there is nothing. This is my understanding of that. So I'm misapprehending it. The second line which I used, you know, was not only misapprehending, but also misconstruing. You know, misconstruing the object, meaning misinterpreting, misconstruing the meaning. It is actually very true. We not only misunderstand, not only misapprehend, but we all together, you know, interpret a different meaning to it, a wrong meaning to it, like misconstrue. In Tibetan, the word is actually very profound for the misconstrue. You know, it therefore the it has these two characteristics, I would like to think, or function to this ignorance. It's not only confused, it's not only confused, but it also, you know, is misinterpreting the meaning altogether. Or misinterpreting the meaning. How can I misinterpret the meaning? Misconstrue, misinterpret. I think oftentimes perhaps that's what we do, right? Okay, now, coming back to this. object-wise, there are few objects. Like, for example, object-wise, first object of, you know, misconstruing or misapprehending are the cause and effect. We have lots of misapprehension about cause and effect, and we misconstrue a lot cause and effect. I come to that back, okay? Then the second object is truth. We, you know, misapprehend the truth. We misconstrue the truth. third are Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, the truth, the three jewels. We misapprehend their meaning, and we also misconstrue them. Like, for example, okay, how do we misconstrue Buddha? If you took Buddha as a creator god, that is and if you taught Buddha as a god with a higher power, that is also misconstruing the meaning of the Buddha. You don't only misunderstand, misapprehend, but you are perceiving it wrongly altogether, you know, misconstruing that way. This is what it meant. This is the reason why then, you know, like now self, okay, self. We not only kind of misapprehend selfless as self, but we, in addition, we misconstrue the self. How? We misconstrue the self by thinking there is this independent self. There is this self that is permanent. There is this self that is true. That kind of falsely perceiving, correct? Falsely perceiving the transitory collections of the five aggregates as self. So falsely misperceiving the transitory collections of five aggregate as self is actually altogether wrong. So ignorance. There is ignorance in everything that we do, actually. It's not a big deal. There is always an ignorance in whatever we do. So the power of the ignorance is such that, that it influences our mind altogether, actually. And therefore, we almost don't see the truth all the time, really. On relative level, on ultimate level, almost all the time we don't really see the truth. The truth that we see, in my understanding, is maybe half true, correct? 30% true, perhaps. But it's not 100% true, actually. We cannot say that it's not true at all. Okay, now again, I'm thinking a lot. Actually, it depends. Who is the perceiver? Correct? Who is the perceiver? If the perceiver is... I think I'm going into all this Tsema stuff, so it'll become very big again. Can't help it being, like that way. But it is actually very true. Depending who is looking at it. Okay, and one example now I found, I think is good. Hopefully it's good for you. Art. You have an art show. Shows of the painting. I go in there, no idea. So you say, how is this? I actually don't like it. No. So now I look at it, I'm like, it's no big deal. But then another person who is a painter, who knows everything about painting, he go crazy about that. And he can pay $10,000. It's very cheap. And I'm like, why you pay $10,000 for this? It's like that. For me, it's not important, correct? But for him, it is. Things like this. Perhaps your friends who are not Buddhist may be thinking the same thing about you guys. These guys, they spend so much money and go there with this Tibetan guy. What they do? They're like, chuk chuk. But then you think they are a little bit chuk chuk. It depends who is actually doing that. Both have some kind of... If you think there is... Both are right on their own right. No. I can't say they are not right. They are right on their own right. And I'm right on my own right. So now who is right? Nobody's right. I'm not playing with the word. I'm really not playing word. But this is the truth. There is an example. Excuse me, In Chandrakirti's book, called Madhyamika Avatara. Did I say it right? Madhyamika Avatara, yes? It's a very beautiful line, actually. It's one of my favorites. There are many favorites, actually, but it's one of my many, many favorites. And then he talks about this, about common... Ooh, Lama Tile is very angry now. He's going to beat me. It's about... Okay, what really clear that way. Every single being on earth agrees that it is that object. Okay, is there? Can you find an object that every single being on earth agrees this is a very beautiful object? Is it possible or no? That's what I meant. Okay, you got it. Then no need to sell the other example. See, I told you. Someone is sitting here. No, but the example of Nagarjuna is, no, I'm sorry, the Chandrakirti is really beautiful. So he talks about, you know, water. Water is perceived differently by all the beings. So now today there's a meeting of six eagle existences, the boss, all the bosses from the hell realm, the boss from the hungry ghost realm, the boss. I'm kidding about the boss though. But let's say these six people meet. Imagine one who is human, one who is a god, one who is animal, one who is hungry ghost, one who is from the hell realm. So these five people, they meet. And now there is water. Okay? So Chandrakirti is, you know, says that all of them, they perceive water differently. Okay, I am a human. For me, it's water. For the god, it's nectar. For the animal, it's living place, like fish. And for other things, it's other things. Correct? No one perceives it as what the other person is perceiving it as. So it's your perception, actually. Your perception decides what that object is. The object notwithstand, is that the word? The object doesn't have any label, doesn't have any nature. So this is what the ignorance of the different sentient beings is doing to them. They all think this is what they perceive. So if this is what they perceive, what about the other person's perception? Correct? And then what about the other person's perception? So then among these five perception about one object, whom can we trust that this is the right? None, actually. None of them is wrong. None of them is right. Because at the end of the day, they all are just, you know, false view. They are all are misapprehension, correct? So that is, you know, the working of the ignorance, generally speaking. Ignorance, how ignorance plays in us. So it doesn't really misapprehend, it misconstrues. That's what I meant, right? For me, it was misconstrued, I guess, as a water, you know? So I think, oh, this is water, I use it, it functions. So there is a benefit out of that. We must know that, correct? There's benefit. I drink the water, it quenches my thirst. It brings energy or whatever. So there is, it doesn't matter that it is an illusion. It doesn't matter that it's a wrong perception. On that level, on that state, on the state of that misperception, where I actually don't have that is a misperception, it's functioning. As long as it's functioning, it works. It's working, correct? That's how karma works. Now, maybe I'm going too much in detail. This is, karma is exactly the same way. But the karma is functioning, correct? That's what matters. That's what counts. Karma doesn't have to be true to function. Karma doesn't have to be an illusion to function. As long as it's functioning, it's functioning. So, you cannot escape from your karma whatsoever. You can't say, oh, karma will not work because it's an illusion. Or you can't say karma will not work because it's emptiness. It works. It functions. It functions because of that nature. That's what I'm saying. It functions because it's emptiness. It functions because it doesn't exist. It will never function if it did exist truly. And we are, that is our, so, you know, misapprehension in us, actually, I think. Okay, so that was about ignorance in brief. So the way how I defined it was, ignorance does not only misapprehend the object, the meaning, it also misconstrues the object. So please think about this misconstrue part. I like that part a little bit better. Somehow I had that, maybe attachment to this idea. So now, due to this karma, ignorance, then ignorance, when the ignorance is functioning, and when it is producing, you know, when it's producing all these misapprehensions, misconstructions, all these confusions in our mind, then all that, you know, is functioning. When it starts functioning, it produces something. It's producing. It's in the process, right? It's a process producing. The product, you know, its product, the product that which is produced by that ignorance is what we term as, what we call, formative action, the second link. So we cannot exactly take it away from ignorance, you know. Okay, so anyway, it's called formative, you know, formative action, compounded action, samskara. I think samskara is the word. I think that is the word, you know. Anyway, compounded karma, composite karma, formative karma. The word actually is compounded. In Tibetan we call duiche. Duiche meaning compounded, composite. Same, right? Compounded, composite, compounded. So, it's composite nature of, you know, actions of the body, speech, and mind. So, in that, from that format, any formative action. So, the formative action, in general, we understand it as the karma. Okay? So, due to this ignorance in us, now, because of our mind being ignorant, then it influences us, you know, to do things through our body, through our speech, through our mind. Some of this ignorance, they are positive virtues. Some of this ignorance are the characteristics of non-virtues, and some of this ignorance, they are of nature of, you know, neither aversion nor attachment or anything, right? Just neutral. Accordingly, then we are, you know, producing the karma, correct? Karma. Accordingly, we are, you know, creating the karma. Positive karmas, negative karma, and neutral karma, that kind of thing. So that, you know, formative action is the term they use, or the compounded karma, you know, we call duche. Is being produced by that ignorance, karma. But then karma, of course, it has, okay, there is karma for the desire realm. The karma for the desire realm are these three karmas which we just spoke. Okay, let's see. Three lower realms, animal realm, hungry ghost realm, hell realm, correct? Okay, feeling-wise, from three kinds of feeling, which feeling, you know, is the feeling that these beings in these three realms go through their entire life? Which feeling? These beings in three lower realms, do they experience joy in their entire life? No, they don't. So therefore, those beings who are in this realm, almost 99% of them, and let's say all of them, you know, they in their entire life, feeling-wise, they go through this feeling of suffering only. And suffering is produced only by negative karma. So we can see that negative action, you know, that are 100% nature of negative karma, produces this particular realm of the beings, of the hungry ghost, of the animal, and of the hell realms. Then, in our human realm, in the God realm, you know, from the experience point of view, in our human realm, I think it's pretty much mixed of everything. But when we compare our existence, you know, to that of existence of those realms in the three lower realm, we almost have no suffering, actually, so to speak, when we compare to them. So therefore, our realm, the human realm, is called the realm of, you know, what we call it as the realm of, you know, pleasant realm or joy realm. And God realm is 100% realm of the joy realm. Now, so that means both the human existence and the existence of the God existence, right, realm, are really the production of good karma only. However, and yeah, okay, without a good karma, can you be born as a human? There's two things, you know. You are born as a human because of your good karma. But in your life, when you go through a lot of suffering, that is what you call the karma that which completes your life. The karma that which completes your life can be a mixture of both good and bad, so you can have both. Or you can have either one of them, depending on what is the nature of the karma that which completes your life. But the karma that which produces your life must be positive. Because without a positive karma, you cannot be a human in the first place. So there's two, okay? The karma that projects your life, so to speak, produce your life, and then the karma that completes your life. So here we are speaking more about the first karma, the karma that produces your life, not that completes your life. It has to be positive. So positive. And of course, God realm is positive, so you can think that way. Now, so there are two karma, right? Positive karma, negative karma. Negative karma only brings the three lower suffering all the time, so three lower realm. Positive karma brings upper realm, so to speak. Is this clear what I'm saying? And now then, what about the desire realm? Okay, that was about the desire realm. So then what about the form and formless realm? Form and formless realm. Form and formless realm, the karma actually is, in Tibetan we call miyowa. Miyowa. Miyowa meaning, literally it actually means, you know, the karma that doesn't move. Karma that does not move. But it actually means, you know, the meaning of that is the samadhi karma, actually. Samadhi karma. Karma of meditation. Because in the form and formless realm, they are born there because of the accomplishment of jine, actually. Highest shamatha meditation, they are born there because of that. So there is that karma. So, and then there is the neutral karma, you know, that which brings about the neutral feeling, so to speak. So due to this, these are part of the formative action. That's why I should brought it up. The formative, the second link, right? Formative action, samskara. Okay. And then this, in turn, this meaning the second link, which is formative action, in turn creates or produces the third link, which is actually consciousness. Consciousness here is, you know, actually the mental imprints of our, you know, activity of our body, speech, and mind. It is both the mental imprints, the habitual patterns, you know, yes, habitual patterns of our body's actions of body, speech, and mind. Generally, we also hear speak about this, you know, consciousness of the alaya consciousness. Okay, alaya consciousness. It has two. Yes, it is the alaya consciousness, and it is also, it is the Alaya consciousness with all the mental imprints of all lifetimes, so to speak. Sometimes they would give you this example of ocean and the wave, you know, ocean and its waves. Waves are like the fruit. So, but here, sometimes we call it colored consciousness. Sometimes you will find the colored consciousness. It's actually quite nice, I think, colored. It's colored by all these, you know, all these karmas of the positive, negative, neutral, and there are so many different shades of positive, different shades of negative karma. So shades, actually shades is a good term, I'm thinking. You know, our mind has so many shades, correct? It's very true. And when this shade of the mind is reflected, we accordingly feel it, I'm thinking. Is that understandable? Let's say, you know, in my mind there's the shade of five colors, as an example. Whichever shade is sort of triggered due to some condition, I accordingly see that shade, you know. Oh, this is sort of bluish, you know. Oh, this is greenish, reddish, not radish, but reddish. I learned how to speak this ish since I was in America, actually. Before that, no idea. So I guess I'm pretty much becoming an American, huh? I must say that because I have the passport. Anyway, so it's like that. It is very, I like that idea, actually. It is really all ish. There's no truth in it, so it's all ish. Three-ish, four-ish, five-ish, and it's like, oh, okay, ish. Whatever, it's ish. Oh, so coming back to that consciousness. But the consciousness is not ish. Please don't say it's consciousness ish. We must also learn something, you know, from this Khenpo, so don't say that. So yes, it's consciousness is actually, you know, that what generally it is, it has two aspects to that. The causal consciousness and the resultant consciousness. This consciousness. Causal consciousness refers to the mental imprints. Mental imprints. Resultant consciousness refers to the, you know, to this consciousness when those imprints are triggered. You know, when these imprints, when those imprints are produced. Correct? So then that is called resultant consciousness. yes, so then this consciousness, okay, I think it's okay. So I think I'll stop here, I guess, no? I need to stop here. I will take some questions if you have. So you are most welcome to ask questions. Oh. Ask. Shh. I will tomorrow finish it. Three. I will tomorrow, no problem. But now I'm thinking I need to say it a little bit maybe faster, I guess. But I will. I will finish them anyways, all the 12. Okay? So tomorrow then I will first list out all 12. Okay. Okay, if you have no question, maybe we can just take the break. Okay? Okay, let's take a break.
Sinam de tamje zibanye tonanye be dana pamje Chega no che balai tu ba ye se ben so len do wa do wa re sho ye ge wan di ye ke wo ye ke se nam ye she cho zo ye se nam ye she le chong wa tam ba ye ke nye to ba re sho ye min jo ro lom bo ku ye ta she sho yen lai tu cho sung ge ta she sho Tadala chime tuje ta shi shu, gave kusun tuje ta shi shu.
Okay, thank you, and you have a great day.
Dear friends, short reminder that all these papers that we will be talking about this afternoon and during next few days are in your email box. So ago, and you will have the text of Shannon.